Carbohydrate molecules vary in length, so some carbohydrate molecules are very long and some are very short. Now, long carbohydrate molecules are also known as polysaccharides, and that's because they consist of many individual monosaccharides. So the simplest sugars are called monosaccharides. They consist of a single sugar monomer. Now, why do we call sugars carbohydrates? Well, if we take a look at the empirical formula for carbohydrates, this is what we're going to find. We see that we have carbon, we have H, and we have oxygen. In fact, we see that we have carbon and we have water. And another name for water is hydrate, and so we have carbohydrates, these molecules that contain carbon as well as water molecules. So the empirical formula is CH2O multiplied by N, where N is basically any positive integer, any positive N value that is equal to 3 or greater. So the simplest monosaccharide contains an N value that is equal to 3. And that means the simple monosaccharide consists of 3 carbon atoms, 6 H atoms, and 3 oxygen atoms. Now, generally speaking, there are 2 types of categories of sugars. We have those sugars that contain aldehyde groups, and these are known as aldoses, and we have those sugars that contain a ketone group, and these are known as ketoses. And to demonstrate what the difference is, let's take a look at the simplest monosaccharide that contains N value that is equal to 3. So this is the ketose that consists of 3 carbons, 6 H atoms, and 3 oxygens. And notice it's a ketose because on both sides of this carbonyl group, we essentially have these carbon atoms. And the specific name for this is dihydroxyacetone. Now, what about the aldose version of this same sugar molecule? So this is what we basically have. And the reason we have 2 of these aldoses is because we have a single stereogenic carbon. We have a chiral carbon, and that means we're going to have 2 different isomers. These are known as enantiomers. Enantiomers are mirror images of one another. So we essentially, on this particular molecule, we don't have a mirror image because we don't actually have a stereogenic carbon. Remember, a stereogenic carbon is a carbon that is chiral, and that means it is attached to 4 different groups. So on this particular molecule, we don't have that, but in this particular molecule, if we examine this carbon, we have 4 different groups attached to this carbon. So we have the hydroxyl, we have the H atom, we have this group here, and this group here. And so what that means is there will be an enantiomer that will exist with respect to this carbon, and this is the enantiomer shown here. So the D-glycoaldehyde simply means that it's one of the enantiomers, and the L simply means it's the other type of enantiomer. And we'll see exactly what the D and L represent in just a moment. So once again, the simplest sugars are monosaccharides, and we call them carbohydrates because the empirical formula tells us they consist of carbon as well as water molecules. So monosaccharides can either be aldehydes or they can be ketones. Aldehyde containing monosaccharides are known as aldoses, and ketone containing monosaccharides are known as ketoses. So the smallest functional monosaccharide, as we said in just a moment, contains an N value of 3. So we have 3 carbon atoms, 6 H atoms, and 3 oxygen atoms. So what exactly is the meaning of the D and the L? And what does the D represent, and what does the L represent? Well, to demonstrate the meaning behind the D and the L letters, let's take a look at another type of carbohydrate molecule, namely erythrose. So let's compare D-erythrose and L erythros. Notice what the D and the L mean is these will be mirror images with respect to one another. These are known as enantiomers. So sugars that are mirror images of one another are known as enantiomers. And so if we draw a line, this will be a mirror image of this molecule. And so these OH groups, which point to this side, will point onto the opposite side on this molecule here. And so in the D isomer, we see that this green hydroxyl group, which is the hydroxyl group that is found on the stereogenic carbon that is farthest away from this aldehyde group, this is the carbon that we have to worry about. And if this hydroxyl group on the final stereogenic carbon points to the right side, then that is the D isomer, the D enantiomer. But if it points to the left side, so that is called the L monosaccharide, in this case, the L erythrose. So the symbol D or L designates the absolute configuration of the stereogenic carbon, the chiral carbon, that is farthest away from the aldehyde or ketone group. And in this particular case, it happens to be the aldehyde group. Now, in D isomers, the OH points to the right side, and in L isomers, it points to the left side. So if this is the left side and this is the right side, then that means in this particular case, it points to the right side, and in this particular case, it points to the left side. So L you can remember as left, and D is the opposite of left, so that's right. Now, the problem with drawing our monosaccharides in the following manner is the fact that the stereochemistry is not actually seen because all these bonds seem to lie along the same plane. But we know that sugar molecules are three-dimensional molecules. They have stereochemistry. And to describe the stereochemistry of sugar molecules correctly, the most common mechanism we use are the Fischer projections. So Fischer projections are commonly used to describe the stereochemistry, the three-dimensional arrangement of the atoms and the bonds within the sugar molecule. And to see what the Fischer projection actually looks like, let's take a look at the following molecule. So this is the same molecule that we essentially described here. It's the D erythrose. So in this particular diagram, the problem with this diagram is all the atoms essentially lie along the same plane and all the bonds also lie along the same plane. But we know that is not true. And to basically go from this diagram to a Fischer projection, all we have to do is we take these horizontal lines and we bring them out of the board. And we take the vertical lines and we place them into the board. And this is basically what we get. This is our Fischer projection. And then if we take this and we actually try to draw a three-dimensional diagram, this is what we're going to get. So notice that this carbon and this carbon, they lie along the same plane. These two will point downward as we see in this diagram. They go into the board or into the page, and these four groups are coming out of the board. As shown here, they're going to come out of the page. So horizontal lines are drawn in front of the plane coming out of the board, while vertical lines are drawn in the back of the plane going into the board. So a Fischer projection is nothing more than a way to basically describe the three-dimensional stereochemistry of the sugar molecule. Now, the final thing I'd like to discuss are distereoisomers and epimers. And as we'll see in just a moment, an epimer is basically a specific type of distereoisomer. So let's think back to organic chemistry for just a moment. So what exactly is an isomer? Well, from organic chemistry, we know that isomers are basically those molecules that contain the same exact molecular formula. So they have the same exact number of atoms and the same type of atoms, but they differ in their arrangement of atoms in the three-dimensional space. Now, we have two types of isomers when it comes to sugars. We have distereoisomers and we have enantiomers. So just a moment ago, we said enantiomers are those isomers that are mirror images of one another. Now, if it's not an enantiomer, then it is a distereoisomer. So we have two categories of isomers, either enantiomers or distereoisomers. So essentially, if two sugar molecules have the same exact molecular formula, and they are not enantiomers, then that means they must be distereoisomers. And these are two examples of distereoisomers. So if we take a look at diurethrose, this is the same molecule that we basically have here. This is an example of a distereoisomer with respect to diurethrose. Notice it contains the same exact molecular formula. It has the same exact number and type of atoms. So here we have 1, 2, 3, 4 carbon atoms, 1, 2, 3, 4 carbon atoms. We have 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6, 7, 8 H atoms, and we have 8 H atoms here. And finally, we have 1, 2, 3, 4 oxygens, 1, 2, 3, 4 oxygen. So essentially, they have the same number and type of atoms, but they differ in their arrangement of those atoms in the three-dimensional space. And notice that these are not examples of enantiomers, because if we draw a line here, they will not be mirror images. And so what that means is, if they're not mirror images, they're not enantiomers, they must be distereoisomers. And so these are two examples of distereoisomers. And notice that these are both the D-type molecule, the D-isomer, because this green hydroxyl group found on the final stereogenic carbon, the farthest away from this aldehyde group, points to the right side. Remember, in the D-isomers, the hydroxyl group found on the last stereogenic carbon points to the right side. If this would have been the L, this would have pointed to the left side, and we would have had this L erythro. So these are two examples of distereoisomers. So when two sugars have identical molecular formulas, have different arrangement of atoms, and are not enantiomers, they're not mirror images, then they must be distereoisomers. Now, a specific subgroup, a specific subcategory of distereoisomers are epimers. So what exactly is an epimer? Well, two molecules are said to be epimers if, or two sugars are said to be epimers if they differ in stereochemistry only at a single chiral carbon atom. And it doesn't matter which carbon atom it is, as long as it's a chiral carbon atom. It's stereogenic. So to see what we mean, let's compare D-glucose and D-mannose. Again, these are both D, and what that means is these two green hydroxyl groups found on a final stereogenic carbon will both point to the right side of the board. Now, let's basically describe all the stereogenic carbons found on each one of these molecules. Let's use a color that, let's use orange. So this is a stereogenic carbon, this is a stereogenic carbon, this is a stereogenic carbon, and this is a stereogenic carbon. Likewise, 1, 2, 3, 4. So these are all stereogenic carbons. Now, these are epimers because they only differ in their stereochemistry at a single one of these chiral carbon atoms. And let's see which one that is. So if we begin at the first chiral carbon, notice that the hydroxyl group points to the right, and the hydroxyl group here points to the right as well. Now, if we move on to the second stereogenic chiral carbon, we'll see that the hydroxyl actually points to the left in D-glucose, but it points to the right in D-mannose. If we move on to the third stereogenic carbon, we'll see that once again, they point to the same side, and the last one, they also point to the same side. So these are epimers, a specific type of distereoisomers, because they essentially differ in their stereochemistry only at a single carbon atom.